Welcome to the fourth episode of the Pine Mountain Sessions at Home. I'm Greg Amrathy, the director of Kentucky Natural Lands Trust. KNLT's efforts launched in 1995 when a group of friends stepped forward to make a difference and work to protect an old-growth forest on Pine Mountain. The selfless act led to a movement of people and organizations coming together in support of our efforts to protect, connect, and restore wildlands. Together, we've protected nearly 50,000 acres of wildlands across the Commonwealth. The power of partnership is essential to our successes. We are grateful to have a strong partnership with many artists from across Kentucky and are proud to continue this long tradition of collaboration between art and conservation. This online series is an extension of this partnership and grew out of the Pine Mountain Sessions recordings released by Danny Martin Moore in 2019 in support of KNLT. Stay tuned for more episodes this summer. Please help spread the word about KNLT and the talented artists taking part in the series. We miss all of you and look forward to taking a walk in the wildlands together when conditions permit. Stay well, friends, and enjoy the show.
Hey, this is Linda Jean Stokley. I perform throughout the region and across the world with my best friend and bandmate, Montana Hobbs, as the local honeys. Right now, I'm here in my creek with Puppy in Woodford County, Kentucky, my farm here. And I've been spending a lot of time outside and writing a lot of music, especially about nature, and how I find a lot of solace within it. I'm very privileged to be asked to be a part of this via the Kentucky Natural Lands Trust, a brilliant organization doing a lot of great work for our home. And this is an episode of authors and musicians from around our great region. There's something in the water here for sure. We all know how to get through these hard times through our creativity, our strength. So we hope that this episode will provide a little bit of solace for you. This is episode 4 of the Pine Mountain Sessions at Home, and thank you for watching.
I greet the morning light. today. Once prized domestic pet ain't worth the price they pay. They've been turned out onto strip mines, get to starving once it snows. They'll wander off the mountaintop that licks salt off of the road. This little girl inside me is chomping at the bit. She cannot save them all, she's hard to admit. Got used to watching horses die, they die badly. It has kept me up at night. I never got used to watching horses die. Count my pretty ponies when I greet the morning light. I never got used to watching horses die. Count my pretty ponies when I greet. Uproots and breaks blows me. just need a little reward. Maybe then I won't cry or need the SSRIs fix me like blown amplifier.
This is Robert Gipe, and I'm from Harlan, Kentucky. I'm reading from a new project called Pop. This is chapter 41. This is Dawn talking. It's called I Relapse. Around noon on Halloween, I woke up on Mamma's kitchen floor and called June. I said, "What are you doing?" And she said, "Run around like a chicken with my head cut off." She said, "Where are you, Dawn?" I said, "Chorus." She said, "How close is the fire? Are you safe?" And I said, "Well, what's safe?" She didn't answer that, and so I asked her another, and I said, "Did you talk to Nicolette?" June said, "I talked to her real early this morning, around 2 o'clock. I said, "Well, what'd she say?" She said, "She asked me about the festival tonight, asked did I want her to come." I said, "At 2 in the morning." And she said, "She caught me checking my messages." And I said, "Well, what else did she say?" She said, she's working on her ninja costume and her zombie bumblebee costumes for the babies." And I said, "Is that all she said?" And she said, "That's all I remember." I was about half asleep, and I knew she's lying because Nicolette was always a ninja, so she wouldn't have to fool with the costume. Also, the baby's bumblebee zombie costumes had been my idea. Their mother had found the bumblebee suits at the Megamart, and I saw her complaining online that they weren't scary. And so I said, well, you can zombie anything. And then they got rotten flesh makeup and fake blood, and now they were zombie bumblebees because of me. I got on the Facebook and looked at what people with lives were doing. And I looked at the Halloween costumes and house decorations and corn maze and pumpkin patch pictures. The dogs painted up like skeletons, and orange and black ice cupcakes, and Grim Reaper baby onesies, and forest fire pictures, and haunted house pictures. And I looked at my cousins and friends trashing old Hillary Clinton, cousins and friends wanting to build a wall. There was a boy on the internet who was in my introduction to college course at the community college, wrote that if we didn't back Trump, we were stupid, un-American cowards. He said people from other countries was dangerous and stealing our jobs, and we had to build a wall to keep them out. I went back through his feeds. There was a lot of automatic weapons fetish videos and jokes about how women couldn't drive and stuff about conspiracies against Christmas and cops. Stuff about how it's fine to beat your kids and even your wife if they didn't do right. I had mostly stopped getting into it with people on the social media. I'd given up keeping up with people's birthdays and congratulating them for every little thing and paying attention to who was in the hospital or whose granny or aunt or father had died. But I wrote that boy and I said, you know they ain't coming to get your gun. You know black people and Mexicans are trying to get along just like you. You know better than to beat on women and beat the shit out of little kids, don't you? Maybe you don't, but I bet you do. I know plenty of people raised hateful and bitter. I've been hateful and bitter myself. I've smacked people in the face, ain't never done nothing to me, or was just trying to help me. So I know. I know how a person gets in that place. But we got to stop. We got to stop beating each other up. We got to stop making people not want to be a part of things because we are tearing each other to pieces. I said, I don't know you. I don't know how you were raised. I know you were raised in this county. I know you were in a community college class with me. You didn't seem horrible then. You gave smart answers to questions. If you was hitchhiking down the road in the rain, I would have picked you up. But now I don't know. And I sat there and looking at what I had typed. And to be honest, I wouldn't have picked up that boy hitchhiking, whether it is raining or not. But still, all that was sad to write. And I wasn't going to hit send, but I did, and I just posted it right on his wall. I saw paralyzing stuff on the internet every day, but the morning I found Nicolette and Hubert, it got to me. I couldn't take that job in West Virginia. I wasn't strong enough, and so I just decided just to stay there at Mamaw's. I went and lay down and got to thinking about Hubert and Nicolette. Felt mad, felt helpless. I got up and got on my laptop and snitched Hubert out on Facebook for every illegal thing he'd ever done. All his killing and law breaking and cheating people and thieving and vandalizing and double dealing. I put every crooked thing I'd ever known him to do on Facebook. And if I had pictures, I put it on Instagram too. And while I did that, that boy wrote back and told me what a soft snowflake liberal I was. He called me a welfare baby, talked smack about my grandmother, called my mother a crack whore, and my brother a junkie. He said my father was spinning in his grave because of the things coming out of my fat-ass lesbo bitch mouth. And I went out on the patio where the breeze blew hard enough to make the wind chimes chime, hard enough to fill the yard with smoke. There were no birds, no squirrels. Everything had moved away from the fire. The animals were squeezed into a smaller space, scared of each other, scared of getting eaten, scared to have babies, but having babies anyway, all jammed up because of a fire on the mountain. Unnatural fire started not by lightning, but by some asshole on an ATV spilled gas down the trail for a mile and then lit it. Why? Because he was mean. Because his mama didn't remember his birthday. Because his daddy beat him with a piece of mining belt. Because he thought he could get paid to help put it out. I don't know why. I no doubt could have found out online, because somebody would be saying who he was and why he done it. Somebody'd be commenting how they always knew he'd do it. I wrapped my arms around myself and rocked in my chair, thought about everyone everywhere, talking about everyone everywhere, commenting. Dry leaves bound to burn blew against my feet and stuck in Mamaw's snowball bush. Weird Russian robot, pro-Trump, pro-gun, pro-hateful posts filled up my inbox. I made me a new Facebook page and started over. 2016, buddy.
Hey, you all. Thank you for tuning in to the Pine Mountain Sessions. I'm Daniel Lobb. I perform as So It Was, and I'll play you two of my songs, and then a cover that hopefully speaks a little bit to this moment that we're living through and working through for the changes that we want to see in this world. It's something you should recognize, so I hope you like it. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken years and learn to cry all your life. You cannot keep waiting, for this moment has arrived. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see all our lies. We cannot keep waiting to let all our people free. Blackbird fly, blackbird fly, into the light, dark black night. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken years and learn to cry all our lives. We cannot keep waiting, for this moment has arrived. This next one I'll play is one of mine. It's called All We Want. And it's kind of my meditation on this culture of domination that defines our society, but especially the culture of masculinity. And it's something that I am very interested in letting go and not participating in as much as I can, this is my reminder to myself to keep to that path. All we once contained. Boys without beauty seen, hungry always, hungry always. Learn to let lust away. Ooh. wait from islands. Wait from my gaze as I am passing through and passed into by everything always. Thank you all for listening. I have one more. It's, I guess it would be the single from the album that I put out last year with Daniel Martin Moore as producer. And just want to take this opportunity to say once again that Daniel is such a gift to our community. I think we all know that, but, he is a fine, fine fellow and a good friend, and I feel very lucky to say that. This one's called One Foot at Once. One foot at once, when will hell have me go down to the creek on stepping stones. The drops of rain then will hold to grow till each in turn is letting go to wash the fossil clean. It doesn't mean no thing. It's just something I've seen. Thank you. Thank you all for listening. I feel so honored to be included in this amazing lineup. I hope you all are enjoying the show.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us for another episode of the Pine Mountain Sessions. My name is Maurice Manning. I'm coming to you today from our front yard in Washington County. And thank you for supporting Kentucky Natural Lands Trust. I'm going to read a poem called The Eating Kind of Shade. Gillis Hatcher had the grace of a hummingbird. He liked to float wherever he went and hardly left a tread in the grass. His porch, however, was a study in contradiction because it sagged like a pair of breeches starved for a belt. If you went over to visit, you had to chock the rocking chair with a piece of stove wood or a brick, or else you'd scoot across the porch and run the risk of sliding off. And the situation was such a fuss, it could be a hindrance to conversation, which in the first place was the reason for going over to see a man like Gillis who lived particular, and the visitor believed some wisdom was in the offing from the visit. "What's holding you back from fixing this porch?" I asked on a visit one afternoon. "You've got a downhill porch on your hands, like it's fixing to break from the house and leave." "This porch is not my worry, son, and you don't need to horn in on it." "I'm not an architect of porches," Gillis said. "My instrument is shade." "Your instrument is shade?" I frowned. "You mean there's music in the shade?" "Well, yes, there's music in the shade because everything is always moving. In the summertime, I concern myself with shade. It's over there in the morning, but in the evening, it's over there." He waved his arms as if he owned a vast kingdom made of shade. "Besides, there's different kinds of shade. There's deep shade, night shade, dappled shade, perpetual shade. There's fast shade and slow shade. And in flat country, I'm told, there's folks who go around with no shade, with no shade, which strikes me as a mite dire." "You sound like a regular scholar on shade," I said, "a man who's bright on shade." "Why, yes, I've noticed the irony that my passion meets my subject crossly. But isn't that the way to meet? One way and another come together?" "It's surely tedious," I said, "but nothing ever hits the mark." "You have to let it hit and see if you can make a mark around it." "You're speaking my language, son," said Gillis, and fetched a ball of string from a bucket. "This here's the secret to dappled shade," and he held the ball like a sacrament. We spent the afternoon weaving the string from the ground in front of the porch to the roof by way of a set of hooks and eyes Gillis had sagely attached to the porch, and pretty soon the whole affair resembled a sizable auto harp, and the two of us were looking out of the body like a couple of birds. "And now," Gillis said, "we plant the greasy beans and the shucky beans and wait for them to climb the string. A little while and we'll have all the dappled shade a man could want. But this here dappled shade I've planted that hasn't even started yet will make two other kinds of shade, the picking kind and the eating kind. And later, when I sit down to supper and eat some shade, you might say shade I made, I'll fill my belly with two of the best things ever in this world." "And what are those?" I asked Gillis. He stared into the future and smiled. "Why, beans and satisfaction, son. And after my repast, I'll sit on this old rickety porch and listen for the breeze to rustle up a tune. I like all manner of shade, I reckon, but you could say my specialty is dappled shade that's also slow, but then you pick it, and then you eat it. And when you come back to the porch to sit, there's nothing to do but gaze at the living instrument of shade and be amused that you've learned how to play it, and play it pretty well."
It's Sunday here in Kentucky. It's Father's Day, actually. I'm out here in a creek in Madison County, and due to COVID-19, I won't be going to work tomorrow or the next day, probably. So it's as good a day as any to sit in the creek and sing an old classic. Thank you.
in and I don't care. Nobody's coming to see me. And I ain't a going nowhere. I ain't gonna work tomorrow. I ain't gonna work. I ain't gonna work tomorrow. For that will be my Monday. It'll be a rough Monday. Rock and ride, leave my heart out by my side.
on my Sycon. Okay. Here's an original song by me. My name is Montana Hobbs, if you didn't know. I'm from Lee County, Kentucky, and Lee County has traditionally always been a dry county that just voted wet about a year ago. But it was always a dry county when I was growing up there. And my parents opened up an establishment in the early 90s, such establishment that you would typically find on a county line when the county next to you is wet. And we sold beer every day but Sunday. And there was a fellow in there that came in there every day but Sunday to buy beer off us. It was the nicest guy. I can remember him as a kid. He was really, really just a sweet man. And he ended up having a pretty tragic story, so I ended up writing a song for him a couple years later. It's called Frank and Billy Buck. He was in the store nearly every single day. It's where he comes to spend his hard-earned pension pay. Frank Blake, he was his God-given name, but he died just giving some folks a ride. Now Frank had a dog that rode with him in his truck. He was just an old mutt, but he called him Billy Buck. It better don't be hard-pressed to find, but he died just being Frankie's pub. A couple of kids were holding out the thumbs. They had a look in their eyes, said I'm on the run. The girl in the store let him use the phone, but it looked like they were on their own. They said, can we Frank Blake, he's blood was on the side. Frank Blakey.